Hello everyone, this is Dr. Bob Browner with CME Coronavirus Update number 85. I hadn't planned on doing another one this week, but with the number of questions and how fast things are changing, people are saying, you know, what would I do to stay during the current surge? If you understand how I'm looking through it, maybe you'll figure out how you would stay safe during the current surge. And I think that's really always a fair question for someone out there putting the things out, is what would you do yourself for you or your own family? So, you know, biggest thing to keep in mind, and I think we need to keep looking at this, is that public health responses are layers of Swiss cheese. None of them are perfect, but when you layer it on top of them, they will keep you safe. So try and figure out what your 2, 3, and 4 layers are and try to use that to kind of guide your thinking. Michael Osterholm had another good update this week where he kind of talked through this. He was widely misquoted about what he was saying about masks. He is not saying that masks don't work. What he's saying is there's a differential effectiveness of masks depending on what kind of mask and what situation you're in. And I think this visual here, this was put together by the San Francisco Public Health Department. I think this is a really good way to explain things. It's degrees of effectiveness. And what Michael Ostrom was saying is that the tightly woven cloth or surgical mask most of us were using during the last phase of the pandemic was probably adequate, but with Delta variant, it's probably not as adequate, especially in certain situations. And given that, you should probably step up to a better or the best mask. And so you could go up to double masking, adjustable straps, KN95 or even an N95, kind of depending on your situation. And so keep this in mind. We'll talk about some scenarios here. I was also asked on a Zoom interview with an organization. It's like, well, you know, what will we be done with masks? And I said, well, you know, you'll be done with raincoats. Well, you're done with raincoats when it's not raining. And of course, when it's raining, then you bring on your raincoat. And so, like, for example, over the summer, I felt pretty confident being both vaccinated with really low levels of spread that I didn't need a mask. And I wasn't wearing a mask very often through most of June and July. However, things are changing. We went from drizzling to raining hard to now we're in the middle of a storm. So it's just a different situation. So another way to think of it is, and I like Moshe Osterholm's, it's like the difference evolution from a lap belt to 3-point seat belts, airbags, ABS, and skid control. You know, I was a kid working on the farm. We had old pickups with just a lap belt. That was okay back then, but you know, I really preferred a 3-point seat belt if you're safe. I was in a car wreck when in college where we totaled the car. I walked away without an injury, but I had a 3-point seat belt on. So that made me a big believer in seat belts. Now we have airbags and even ABS and skid control. So, you know, if I'm just driving to the dump in an old pickup, maybe I'm okay with a lap belt. But if I'm in the interstate, I kind of want something a little better. And if I'm in the interstate and it's storming or icy or something like that, I want the seat belt, the airbags, ABS, and the skid control. And I think that's kind of the situation we're in right now. So, for example, if I'm just going to go into the quick shop just to pay my bill or to get something, I might be okay with just a surgical mask because I'm vaccinated. However, if I'm going to sit through a meeting for an hour or two with a lot of people with questionable vaccination status who may or may not be masking, I'm probably going to step up to either double masking or a KN95 or something like that. And if I'm going to be in repeated high-risk situations, I might want to look at an N95. And so use those to kind of guide your situations. They do make some KN95s for kids, for example, when you get off Amazon. And so you may want, given we don't know exactly how we're going to start and how the situation is going to work, it kind of depends where you live right now, you may want to do a little extra to protect you and your family. Impression is that, you know, KN95s aren't exactly the same certification as an N95, and it's hard to give a standard short way to know that the KN95 is okay. You can Google this, and I put a link in the notes section. You can kind of go through, here's what to things to verify that a KN95 isn't it's easy up to snuff, or at least not a counterfeit or something like that. And so if you're really worried about whether that KN95 you bought is good, this is a good article to take a look at. So again, you know, we've gone from drizzling to storming now, and so I think it's time for all of us to be safer. Even if you're vaccinated, you should start wearing a mask in those certain situations, like I just mentioned. You know, even my own family, my daughter's very healthy, young, being a healthy young woman, I'm not as worried about her as I might be somebody older. But on her plane flight, I've recommended she get a KN95 when we got those for her. Hospitalizations continue to rise, and the hospitals are all full. There are no extra ICU beds. And the problem is that right now, we have now hit a threshold where mortality is going to go up, not just for coronavirus, but for everything else. The statistics are pretty solid that when the nurse to patient ratio starts going up in an ICU setting, mortality goes up for everything. And unfortunately, when you hit capacity from now on, mortality gets a bit worse, not just for coronavirus, but even for heart attacks or strokes or other things, because we're going to start really taxing our nursing staff. staff. And so we need to do everything we can to slow this down because the mortality goes up for everything now. We are at capacity. I'm hearing more and more stories of ICUs from other states asking us if they'll take our patients and us telling them no. So we need to slow this down as much as possible to give our nurses and respiratory therapists and doctors in the hospital a break here. Other things that have come up lately are things about monoclonal antibodies and booster shots. And so, for example, here's this audio interview from the New England Journal of Medicine where they kind of review some of these things. And so monoclonal antibodies are sort of artificial antibodies to help your immune system. The times where these are going to be very effective, and now we have some good studies on them, you know, if you are high risk and you get COVID, you should get the monoclonal antibodies as soon as possible. Things like Regeneron or those, they're usually available at the hospital. Your doctor can usually, if you contact them, can help connect you, but they have to be given right away. You can't wait 1 to 2 weeks. You can't wait and see how it's going to go. You need to get it within a couple days for it to be effective. But they are very effective in decreasing both hospitalization and death. The other thing is the concept of passive immunity. So, for example, let's say that you, for whatever reason, can't get a vaccine, or because the vaccine isn't very effective for you, you can actually use these intermittently to develop some passive immunity. And so, some folks, for example, with certain immune conditions, you should probably talk to your doctor about the possibility of actually getting a monoclonal antibody shot to protect you during this surge. They may be effective for a couple months, and so that's another option. The other thing is booster shots. We're already getting studies now. So, for example, they're already studying them in high-risk people. France and other countries are already studying and are starting to do this. There is now a trial of Moderna in transplant recipients where the third dose does appear to give them some additional protection. So we're already starting to do third doses in high-risk people, and I think this is kind of where we're headed. So the take-home messages on this is if you are high risk and get COVID, get monoclonal antibodies as soon as possible. And if you have an immune system problem that likely limits the effectiveness of your vaccine, or you can't get one, talk to your physician about passive immunization with the monoclonal antibodies, because this may be something that might help you as well. And last, you know, booster shots are appearing more likely, and I would bet that we're headed that way for everybody at some point. They're already approved for high-risk patients. I would not fault anyone who had J&J with going ahead and getting a booster with Pfizer or Moderna in the next few weeks. There's no official recommendation yet, but I sure wouldn't stop you. And it's not unusual for vaccination recommendations to change over time. So some historical context here, for example. When I was in college, people only got one mumps, measles, and rubella shot. But then we had an outbreak at Creighton, and a lot of my classmates got measles. And so that's why we now get a second dose. And so we find out sometimes over time that the dosage we currently have is not adequate, and you get a supplement, for example. Unfortunately for coronavirus, it's not at all like measles, mumps, and rubella. A lot of people with the natural herd folks thought that it was a one-and-done thing. It's pretty clear that with coronavirus, one shot, once you get it once, you are still going to get it again. That's why so many other vaccines have multiple doses. So, for example, if we look up here at diphtheria, tetanus, and pertussis vaccines, you get a first, a second, a third dose in infancy. You get a fourth dose as a toddler. You get another fifth dose about kindergarten. You get yet another dose when you hit middle school, and then you keep getting more doses every 10 years because the immunity wanes over time. So you keep getting doses of both tetanus, diphtheria, and pertussis. That's not unusual. And so this is the kind of thing we find out over time. And if coronavirus mutates like in influenza, it would not be surprising if we get annual vaccinations like we do with influenza because of the mutation. So it could be that you get a yearly coronavirus shot in the future. We'll find over time. And so it's not unusual for us to learn as we go and adjust these regimens. And so that doesn't mean that the fact that we're changing this to give a booster does not mean the vaccine doesn't work. It's just that we're learning over time what works best. And it takes data and time to figure that out. So hopefully we're getting more and more people to start really understanding here that stop a pandemic, it's going to take multiple layers, not just vaccines. We need to vaccinate at least 80 to 90% of the population, which should get much easier as we start hearing of more and more employers requiring the vaccine, whether you're a military or a hospital worker or working at Tyson. That's going to increase our vaccination rates. We do need to put a vaccine verification system with negative test option for those who can or can't in place so that we can make these other venues safer as soon as possible. Mask in common places, like we just covered, and then we do need to do a better job about the rapid testing, contact tracing, and isolation to fully get this under control. Unfortunately, we could be doing surges every 6 to 8 months until we get it all together. I hope we do. So hopefully this is helpful to you. This is kind of what I do for a living, but usual disclaimer, these are my opinions, not those of who I work for, but this is so you know, can verify that I am who I am and I do what I do.